what the Lord is doing with the Gideons.
God bless you, brother.
Well, thank you so much for having us here today. This is the first time my wife and my girls have gotten to come with me to when I've given a church presentation, and we didn't know how my girls would do, so we asked if they'd send us to a church that was kid-friendly, and thank you very much. It's wonderful to be in a church where there are so many young kids. For the power of God is living and powerful, and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Hebrews 4:12. That was the scripture that Rosie Putnam of South Carolina began to read in early 2004 because she wanted to win an argument with a friend and prove once and for all that the Bible was wrong. She was 27 and convinced that the Bible was both errant and fallible. And what she didn't know was the nature of the battle that she was about to get into. She didn't know that the gospel is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. Romans 1:16. She was living a life trusting in herself as God. Now, Rosie grew up in a church in Halifax, Nova Scotia. She loved singing the hymns and carols and participating in Christmas and Easter pageants, but she completely missed the gospel. She attended a university and studied anthropology and international development, and these two areas of study convinced her, and it confirmed her thinking that there were some very wrong ways of the world. Now, she looked for answers in different religions and philosophies and economic systems and in performing acts of service. She hoped that eventually she would be in the right place or be in the right relationship, and then she would find contentment and peace instead of disappointment and loneliness. It was during this time when she was pursuing worldly things that the Lord pursued her. While attending college in Montreal, Gideons were handing out New Testaments, and she took one, and it sat in her apartment for months. When she finally did start to read it, she began to read it with a spirit of aggravation. A friend she had met while on an internship in South Carolina was unrelenting in trying to get her to discuss the gospel. He suggested that they start in the book of Matthew together. And Rosie agreed with the intention that once and for all she would put these arguments to rest. Now, her friend suggested that she read her New Testament on her long bus and subway rides. Now, Rosie was a little reluctant because people just don't read the Bible in public in Montreal. But the Lord quickly proved her wrong. She began to notice other people reading their Bibles in the buses and on the subways. One day, a man approached her in the subway and pulled out his Gideon New Testament and asked her if she ever read the Bible. He opened up his New Testament to Matthew, and he began to read the same scripture that she had read earlier that morning. Now, Rosie began praying at the suggestion of her friend. She mostly prayed prayers of gratitude, and it was becoming clear to her the more that she read and the more that she prayed that all things were from God, and she began to acknowledge Him in all things. The more she read and studied the scripture, the more she realized that she was going to have to confront a terrifying question. Either the whole Bible was wrong, or the whole Bible was right. And if the whole Bible was right, then she would have to reconsider everything in her life. Her whole life up to that point was based on the philosophy that there were no absolute truths. There were no amounts of conversations or persuasive arguments that would have led her to the point that she was at. And she will tell you that it was only by her prayer and the Word of God, reading His Word, that she came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And she realized that He alone is worthy of her trust, her faith, and her belief. Now, the Lord moved Rosie from Canada to South Carolina, where she did eventually marry that friend who is so tenacious in getting her to discuss the gospel. Now, Gideon's International is an association of born-again Christian, business, and professional men. Since 1899, our purpose has been to share the gospel with the world. And we do this by distributing God's word and by personal witness. Today, we are organized in 190 countries, and we distribute Bibles in 90 different languages. Now, that's three more countries than we were in at this point last year, and two more languages that the Bibles are being printed in. We place Bibles in certain designated areas, places like hotels, motels, hospitals, nursing homes, convalescent centers, as well as doctor's offices and dentist's offices, and at least one veterinary hospital back in Lyon County, which is where I work. We distribute New Testaments to students in colleges and schools, to prisoners, to police, fire, medical personnel, as well as men and women in the armed forces. We are members of local churches, and we are an extension of the mission arm of our local churches. And we work in partnership with believers like you around the world. And part of our mission is to visit congregations to let you know how God is using the words, the seeds that we are sowing. 100 years ago at the Gideon's International Convention in Louisville, Kentucky, a proposal was made and passed that Gideon's would try to put a Bible in every hotel room across the country. Now that was no small task considering how many fewer Gideons there were then. And a preacher from Iowa heard about this plan, and he decided that his church would help. He said, "We can't go as a church to do that, but if you're willing to do that and Gideons around the country are willing to do that, we will help you buy the Bibles to put the Bibles in the hotel rooms." And that is how churches have become the most important part of raising money so that we can purchase Bibles and distribute them in hotels and motels and in other areas. By God's grace, we distributed more than 77 million scriptures last year alone. Approximately 1.5 billion scriptures have been placed around the world since 1908. Isaiah 55:11 says, "So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it." Now that promise is being fulfilled as men, women, boys, and girls come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ through reading a scripture placed by a Gideon. Ursula Link lives in Freiburg, Germany. On New Year's night in the year 2000, her daughter Stephanie was brutally murdered. Afterward, life was nearly unbearable for Nadine and for Ursula. And Nadine was Stephanie's younger sister. She was 14 at the time of her sister's death. 2 years after Stephanie's death, Nadine attempted to commit suicide because she could no longer bear what had happened to her sister. And she received psychiatric treatment, but it just didn't seem to help very much. In November 2002, through the witness of a friend, both Ursula and Nadine came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Many Christian people came into their lives and helped them in their times of despair, showed them God's love, and spoke to them about God's Word. About 6 months later, things finally seemed to be going well for them. But Ursula had this nagging feeling. She was so happy and grateful that her and Nadine would spend eternity in heaven, but she was just worried and upset that her daughter Stephanie, they'd never see her again in heaven. When Ursula finally felt strong enough to go through Stephanie's things, she began to look through her drawers and empty things out, and she came across a little New Testament. And she felt led to open it up. And she opened it and she flipped through the pages, and she ended up on the last page in that book, on the back cover, where there's a prayer of salvation and there's a place to sign and date your name. Stephanie's name was signed and dated when she was 11 years old. Ursula can know without a doubt now that someday she and Nadine will get to see her other daughter again. Now, I just learned the other day, just yesterday, about a situation from a group of Gideons that went to Western Kentucky University, actually, to distribute Bibles to the students there. And they were distributing those Bibles in the pouring rain. A young man came by, and the Gideon tried to hand him a New Testament. And the student said, "No, thank you, I'm an atheist." And as he continued to walk on, the Gideon said, "Well, how's that going for you?" And which we don't usually speak a lot about that to people. We will witness when it's appropriate, but during a distribution, a lot of times we just will hand out the New Testaments and let God's Word speak for itself. But this Gideon felt led to say something to the student, and it got his attention, so he came back. And he was able to start talking to him. He gave him a New Testament, and he showed him some things in there. We don't know what that student's situation is right now, but I will ask you to pray for that student. We hopefully, with that New Testament and with the words that Gideon has said, he will come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ also. Now, Jesus instructed us to go ye into all the world, Mark 16:15. How can we do that? And how can you help us place God's word into the hands of a lost and dying world? First and foremost, we need your prayers. Your daily prayers are vital to our ability to continue to put God's word into the hands of people who need it the most. Please pray for a steady flow of funds so that scriptures can be purchased. And please pray for open doors in communities, in countries, and in schools that need them the most. There are some countries where these New Testaments, these Bibles, are the only books that these students will ever receive. And if we can't get those books there, we can't get those Bibles there, then they may not ever know the Word of God. There are communities in our own state, in my county of Lyon County, our local school does not allow us in the doors anymore. We have to stand on the sidewalk to distribute New Testaments there. So pray for those doors to open up, that we can get back into our classrooms, and that we can continue to give New Testaments to the students who need them. There are an estimated 4 billion lost people in the world today, in a population of over 6 billion. If that number is correct, then nearly 2 out of every 3 people who die today will not spend eternity in heaven. And that number is just not good enough. Second, today, that you can give if the Lord is leading you to do so. 100% of the money that is given goes toward the purchase and distribution of scriptures. None of it goes toward administrative costs. That's what my dues and the dues of other Gideons across the country and across the world go to pay for. And third, you can use the Gideon Card Program, which used to be called the Memorial Bible Card Program. What better legacy to leave when someone passes on than a Bible in that person's memory? There are also thinking and in recognition of you cards. There's also a new line of cards that the Gideons have developed, which can be purchased from the Gideon website, which is www.gideons.org. I'm not trying to sound like a commercial here. I'm not trying to take away from Hallmark or Walmart. But these cards, when they're purchased through the website, every card that's purchased will place at least 1 to 2 New Testaments. So just by sending a card to someone, you're sending God's word. There are also Easter and Christmas cards as well when those seasons come up. Now someday there may be a Gideon bringing a presentation in a church that has a testimony like the ones that I've shared today that is made possible because of someone in this church. We may never know this side of heaven what our money goes toward and where those Bibles end up and whose hands they go to. But you can rest assured that because God promises his word will not return void, that we will reap a reward because of those Bibles that are placed. At the close of this service, you will have the opportunity to give if God is leading you to do so. For every $5 Bible that is placed, it has the potential to reach nearly 2,300 people in its average 6-year lifespan. A box of 100 New Testaments costs approximately $130. And those are like the ones that we give to our students, our fifth grade students. And we have a lot of work to do. The country of India alone requests more scriptures in 1 year than we can place around the world in an entire year. Also, if you are a business or professional man and you feel that the Lord may be leading you to do something more than what you're doing in your life, but you don't know what that might be, talk to me after the service about potential ways that you can serve in the Gideon ministry. Thank you all so much for allowing us to come in and share about the worldwide ministry of the Gideons International. Thank you for your attention and for your support. I just ask that you would continue to pray for this ministry, and that more than anything else is what will pull us through and what will help us get God's word out. Thank you again.
At the end of the service, Brother Kyle will be standing at the back. He'll have either his Bible or that notebook. Maybe that notebook would be more sufficient, so we'll have more room to put more money in. Amen? Amen. And I suggest that we as a church, as a congregation itself, not individuals, but as a congregation itself, buy at least one case of those New Testaments to give. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Let me make a couple of really quick announcements and we'll get to the reading of the Word. You go ahead and take your Bibles. Are the sermon notes, have they been passed out? Amen. Go ahead and turn to Psalm 106. Let me ask for your prayers very quickly. Messenger has a tremendous workload coming up this week and this weekend. We've got some adjustments that we have to make. But we've also got some awesome opportunities coming up for us. And so we appreciate your prayers. Busy weekend. The tearing down of stuff and then the putting back of stuff. And thankfully for the guys in the back, they don't have to tear down anything this weekend. And so they'll shout amen. But we appreciate your prayers. Then the next thing I want to talk about, I took this off the door, Stephanie, so you'll have to replace it. But there's a coming up on October 17th. The trip to the Creation Museum. How many of you all have heard of the Creation Museum? All right, if you've been here for any of the announcements, you know. It's kind of funny, kind of like the Bible being placed out. This Creation Museum was fought against tremendously to even allow it to be built. And the people that were fighting against it were supposed to be the people who practiced tolerance and acceptance and love and everything like that, but they didn't want this in place because this is a major blow to evolution. It's a major blow. Just this place. So we're going on October 17th. We're leaving here at 11 sharp. Everybody say 11 sharp.
11 sharp.
Try that again.
11 sharp.
Okay, that's not 11:05 or 11:10, 11:15. It's 11 sharp. Okay? We're going to try to have mass transportation arranged. If you meet us along the road, we'll let you park your car somewhere along the side of the road and we'll pick you up and take you with us. But 11 sharp we're pulling out of here because we're going to have to maximize our time. It's kind of a compromise for our hunters. Some of the guys, it's one of the few opportunities they'll get to put a deer in their freezer. We made a mistake by not realizing Kentucky hadn't updated their website yet. And so we downloaded a calendar for the dates, gave it to Stephanie. She looked on it. No hunting on the 17th, so we took the 17th. Blah, blah, blah. There you go. Just the prices, if you're between 13 and 59, $16.95, roughly $17. Seniors, 60 and up, $12.95. 5 to 12, $8.95. Children under 5 are free. Now, that doesn't mean if you act like you're under 5, you have to be under 5, all right? We will not be stopping on the way up to eat. So eat before you come or bring a snack with you as you go. We will be eating on the way back, amen? And it will be a buffet for those of you who are wondering, amen? I want to take just a moment and recognize something of significance. First of all, I don't always get this done, and I apologize for not always getting it done, but we have a new visitor today, right back here in the back, Bruce and Cheryl's latest addition. Are y'all going to raise this one too? There is Lauren, that is Bruce and Cheryl's newest grandbaby. We want to give the Lord praise for her, amen. And then this morning, he did a great job. It was the first time that he has ever played the drums in public. Didn't he? And do a good job. So now I've really embarrassed him. But you can play. I believe I speak for everybody else. You can play with us anytime you want to, son. You did a fine job. He's turning red. I think it's a reflection off of it. Tonight's Bible study, chapter 13 in the book of Revelation. We're going to start at 6. We're talking about the image of the beast. This has been a very interesting study. I gave you all a little homework assignment last Sunday night to go and search it out on the internet. What is the image of the beast? What does that mean? What are the implications? I've had some people that have done it that's looked at me and said, oh my goodness, brother, I cannot believe everything I found. Do you want to be here tonight, all right? 6 o'clock, food and fellowship until 6:30. We're going to start with the study because we've got some things to cover tonight. So bring food, amen?
Amen.
And we'll have a good time in the Lord. Psalm 106. Amen. We welcome you into this time of worship and praise. Now the preaching of the Word is an extension of the worship. Look what the Word of God says. Praise the Lord! Exclamation point. Praise the Lord. Everybody say that. Praise the Lord. Oh, come on. See, y'all act like you're in a Baptist church on Sunday morning and you said, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Do you know that we have some of the worst reputation amongst all the churches because of our Sunday morning services? Joke after joke after joke has been spawned by Sunday morning Baptist services. Some of them have been like this. There was a man who had a heart attack in the Sunday morning service, and the ambulance crew removed 10 wrong people before they found the right guy. We have names like the Frozen Chosen, that we can claim the promise when it says the dead in Christ shall rise first, that that'll be the Baptist on Sunday morning. It all stems out of the fact that we can't let go and just accept the Word. The Word of God said, praise the Lord! There's an exclamation point at the end of that. I don't know if it is in your Bible, but it is in mine. How many have an exclamation point after that little proclamation there? Praise the Lord! Now, it's kind of awesome that this particular chapter in this particular topic starts out like this. Praise the Lord. Then it goes on. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. For His mercy endures forever. How many of y'all are glad for that?
Amen.
Amen? His mercy endures forever. Who can utter the mighty acts of the Lord? Who can declare all His praise? Blessed are those who keep justice, and he who does righteousness for at all times. Remember me, O Lord, with the favor you have toward your people. Oh, visit me with your salvation, that I might see the benefit of your chosen ones, that I may rejoice in the gladness of your nation, that I may glory with your inheritance. All of a sudden it takes a tenor of repentance. We have sinned with our fathers. We have committed iniquity. We have done wickedly. Now, watch where it happens. What happens here? Look at the explanation. Look at the things that are said. Our fathers in Egypt did not understand your wonders. They did not remember the multitude of your mercies. They rebelled by the Red Sea, the sea. Nevertheless, He saved them for His namesake, that He might make known His mighty power. He rebuked the Red Sea also, and it dried up, and He led them through the depths, as through the wilderness. He saved them through the hand of him who hated them, and redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. The waters covered their enemies. There was not one of them left. Then they believed His words. They sang His praise. Boy, it's good to praise God when you're feeling good, isn't it? Huh? Look at the next verse. They soon forgot His works. They did not wait for His counsel. They lusted exceedingly in the wilderness and tested God in the desert. And He gave them a request, but sent leanness into their soul. When they envied Moses in the camp and Aaron, the saint of the Lord, the earth opened up and swallowed Dathan and covered the faction of Abiram. A fire was kindled in their company. The flame burned up the wicked. They made a calf in Horeb and worshipped the molded image. Thus they changed their glory into the image of an ox that eats grass. They forgot God their Savior, who had done great things in Egypt, wondrous works in the land of Ham, awesome things by the Red Sea. Therefore He said that He would destroy them, had not Moses, His chosen one, stood before Him in the breach, to turn away His wrath, lest He destroy them. Then they despised the pleasant land. They did not believe His word, but complained in their tents. I believe the King James says there, they murmured. And did not heed the voice of the Lord. Therefore He raised His hand in an oath against them, to overthrow them in the wilderness, to overthrow their descendants among the nations, and to scatter them in the lands. For the sake of time this morning, I'm going to stop there. But understand that this is a psalm that starts out that we ought to praise God and we ought to be glorying in God and out of His goodness to us to serve Him continuously. But then it jumps into a warning of what happens in the typical course of life. We go up and we go down. We go up and we go down. We come in and we go out, and we go round and round in circles. I want to talk to you today about this topic, because you murmured, from Psalm 106. Now, at the very first of this, it's been a four-part series. We exposed murmuring, then we examined murmuring, we talked about the effects of murmuring, and today we're going to talk about eliminating murmuring. Eliminating murmuring. How many would like to get it out of your life? Amen? Murmuring. What is murmuring? How do we define murmuring? Murmuring is complaining, grumbling, mumbling in a fashion where no one can understand us. Do you know most gossip is done where the person that's being talked about can't hear what's being said? Amen? Now, let me start you off with something that'll make you smile. Before Randall was prophesying to us in prayer about hard sermons. So let me start you off with a smile before we get to the tears. Amen? How many of y'all remember or heard of, most of us probably will not remember, but have heard of the Johnstown, Pennsylvania flood? Anybody? A few of you heard it? Several thousand people died. It was a period of time of rain. I think about 3,700 people died. There was one particular man who miraculously survived the flood. And it became his mission in life to tell every person he met about how he survived the Jamestown flood. To the point that eventually he became obnoxious in that he just wouldn't shut up. All the time had to tell people about how he survived. Eventually they say the old man died, and when he got to heaven, he was continuously running to the throne of Jesus saying, I want to tell my story. All the other saints were telling things, and Jesus kept putting him off and putting him off. And finally he got up there and he said, I want to tell my story next to how I survived the flood of Johnstown. And finally Jesus said to him, all right, listen. If you will sit down and be quiet, there's one more person that's going to testify and then you'll be next. And the man said, all right. And then Jesus said, all right, Noah, come tell your story. Amen. Eliminating murmuring. Here's the first thing that you need to do, and I believe I already flashed it up there, is recognize that we all murmur from time to time. Is there anybody in the room that can say, I am immune to this, it has never happened to me? How many can say, I have been frequently guilty of murmuring? Amen? Now, I've talked about this because it takes on so many forms. And sometimes we feel like we are righteous in our complaining. But if you go back to all the way back to where we began to first talk about murmuring and then exposing, one of the things that we said is that murmuring has with it the connotation or the idea of rebellion. Always the idea that I'm saying or putting forth, if I was in charge, I would not be doing it this way. To the point that it begins to affect our attitude, our behavior, and our performance. So the first thing in a step in eliminating murmuring is recognizing that we... Now, you know, it's easy to see somebody else's faults, isn't it? Come on. Amen? It's easy to see somebody else's faults. But it's harder when somebody else is pointing out ours or when we come face to face with them ourselves. You know what? I would rather find my own fault than have somebody else point it out to me. Amen? All right, the second thing I want to come to this is understanding the consequences of murmuring. I believe that if we can start recognizing and then understanding, and we talked about this last week, so I'm not going to rehash this, but understanding the consequences or the effects of murmuring. Now, I want to say really quickly, because in case everybody has kind of forgotten, because we don't make a great big deal of it, all our Sunday morning services, we broadcast on the internet. Brother, you were on the internet a few minutes ago. I forgot to tell you. I hope you, if you don't like it, we'll strike you out. But we'll eliminate you. I think in Apocalypse Now, they said, terminate with extreme prejudice. But periodically, people will watch on the internet and they'll see sermons and they'll be, I wonder what's going on down there at Beach Grove. I wonder who he's talking to. Well, listen, honey, I want you to understand. If you're watching this or listening to this, I'm talking to whoever this applies to. Amen. These are things that I wish that every pastor would deal with, because I believe that if we could ever get this idea that we have a right to complain and we have a right to gripe and we have a right to fuss and feud and carry on, I believe if every church could get this issue under control, the body of Christ would be so much stronger and so much more effective than where we are today. Amen? It would strengthen marriages. It would strengthen families. It would help us in our job performance. It would help us in every aspect of our life. So if you're wondering who I'm talking about, I'm talking to you. And you. Understanding the consequences of murmuring. Listen, you cannot take fire into your bosom and not get burned by it. That's what the Word of God says. So we have to understand that if murmuring brings the curse of God, we can't participate in it and expect to live a blessed and holy life. Then thirdly, remember what murmuring really is. Now we think it may just simply be as simple as complaining, but I want you to understand that the Bible says that murmuring is sin. Everybody say sin. Should Christians participate in sin? The book of Romans says, should we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid! You as parents, would you like for your children to drink poison? No. Why not? We want the best for our children, right? What about a poison that doesn't kill them right away? What about if they can drink a little bit of a time? We don't want them to have it at all, do we? And yet, somewhere along the line, in our churches, in our doctrine, we've got our people convinced that, well, if it's not a big sin, So how do you define big sin? Is big sin like the difference between white lies and black lies? Or big lies and small lies? Does the Bible differentiate, or does it say all liars will have their part in the lake of fire? What about sin is it that we seem to think that that one's okay? We call them pet sins. A pet sin is like having a pet lion at your house. Eventually the lion is going to revert to its wild nature and bite you. Amen? I just watched that on Discovery. That's how I know. It's sin. But secondly, I want you to understand that murmuring is wickedness. Because most of the time, when we take part in stuff, we may not realize that something is a sin initially, but when we get involved in something and we give ourselves over, we slip into that wickedness. And I want to tell you something. There are diabolical things that take place in the heart of people that participate in murmuring. It's wickedness. It leads to horrible places that we don't need to go to. It's also ignorance. Now, how many of you think that ignorant, when you use the word, you say somebody is ignorant, how many of you remember growing up that was a horribly negative term? And they had words like ignoramus. Anybody ever heard that word? But see, the word ignorant actually is not that bad if it's understood. If you're ignorant of the word ignorant, then you will use it ignorantly and become an ignoramus. Ignorant means unlearned. And I would like to believe that Christians who participate in murmuring do so because they're ignorant of what murmuring really is. Amen? I don't want to think that we willfully participate in it. All right? It's rebellion. It's forgetfulness. Remember here in this passage of Psalm 106? I didn't even read the whole thing. But several times the writer says they forgot what God had done. Amen? I remember a Southern gospel song from the late 80s that was entitled, "Look What God Has Done For You." Now, let's be honest. In this room, is there anybody who could say faithfully here today that if God never did anything else for you, what He has done already is sufficient cause for you to serve Him from now through eternity? Amen? He doesn't have to do anything else, does He? You see, here's what we do to God, because we do to God what we do to our friends. We demand performance from our friends. As long as you keep me happy, as long as you do what I expect of you. But see, in friendships, in relationships, the only expectation that we have is that in the reality is that we need to be there for each other in good times or bad times, and to be faithful to each other, to be what the word I love is loyal. You know what I like about what I want from my friends? I don't always get that, and I'm probably not always that way myself. But I want my friends to like what I like and to dislike what I dislike. That's kind of why we flock to people, because we flock to people that we tend to be a lot alike. But when something comes down and my friends don't come down on the same side that I'm on, I kind of feel like I've been betrayed, because I want my friends to be what I think is loyal to me. Anybody know what I'm talking about? And then we do God in the same fashion. We want God to perform for us and to do everything that we expect from Him. And yet, how often do we check to see, have we performed what God expects from us? You say, well, thank God we're New Testament Christians. There's nothing required from us. Oh, contraire, mon frère. Have you not read the Bible? At least take Jesus' teachings, for example. And He said, "This is my commandment. It's the greatest of all and the hardest of all to perform, that you love one another." Are you still with me? Jesus placed some demands and some commands on us, and yet we look upon His performance. And it's kind of like this: what have you done for me lately? What have you done for me right now? Well, I prayed and God didn't answer my prayer. Listen, every prayer, my friend, gets answered. But you need to understand, you and I need to be mature enough to understand that sometimes the answer is no. How many parents in the room have ever had to tell your children that you gave birth to, your children that you have cared for, your children that you love, how many have ever had to say to them, no? Anybody? Why did you do that? Are you mean? Or did you love them and what they wanted they shouldn't have? So sometimes He says yes. Sometimes He says no. Sometimes He says not right now. And then I've got to be honest. Sometimes I think He says, "You have got to be kidding me." That's just my supposition. Murmuring is destructive. Murmuring corrupts our worship. Remember what happened to the children of Israel. It's mentioned here in this passage. Moses is up on the mountain. They begin to complain. They get impatient. And they're like to Aaron. They said, what has happened to this Moses? We don't know. Maybe we should go back to Egypt. Maybe we should go back where we came from. Build us a golden calf. And the next thing you know, they're down around the calf worshiping. Listen, you cannot have your heart right with God and live in murmuring. Murmuring separates us from God and from each other. Murmuring changes us. You say, how so? It changes in this fashion. It is hard to be face to face with somebody you've been talking about. Amen? You know why? Because you're afraid that somehow they know that you've been sticking. You know, we used to talk about the knife, but I'm afraid sometimes we stick a pitchfork. Get them 6 or 7 times in one jab. Amen. It brings us into bondage. It changes us. None of these aspects of we need to understand these things and to remember them and to know what it really is. And then now we're going to get to this good part. Let's begin to deal with murmuring. How do you say? Everybody say how. Well, I'm glad you asked. First of all, we have to take the blame for our own mistakes. Take the blame for our own mistakes. You know, the children of Israel were constantly blaming Moses, blaming God, or blaming somebody. You say, well, where did they get that from? Well, they got that from their daddy. Who's your daddy? Adam. What did Adam do? The woman you gave me, it's her fault. And guys, ever since then, we have been looking for somebody to place the blame on. But I want to tell you something. In the book of 2 Samuel, I believe it's chapter 12, the only response to acknowledging sin is when the prophet Nathan confronted the king David and he said, you have sinned against God, and the result of your sin is that the enemies of God have now been given a great opportunity to blaspheme His name. It's kind of like our president running around the country, or running around the world, talking our country down, apologizing for our country, saying all these negative things about our country, and now the enemies of America are saying, see, their president doesn't even like that country. Does that make sense? That's what King David did whenever he sinned. He gave God's enemies a chance to say horrible things about God. But when the king was confronted, he said, I have sinned. If you want to, right out there beside, take the blame, write Psalm 51 down there. And if you've never read Psalm 51, sometime in the next few days, take the time to read Psalm 51. So in dealing with, we have to first take the blame. Secondly, we have to thank God for what He has done. How many can think back to a momentous occasion in your life when God did something awesome for you? Just give me 3 people who right now would just stand up and tell what God has done for you. Just real quick, don't wait, don't wait. It's going to pass you by if you don't go quickly. Amen. Amen. God saved our marriage. God has given me wisdom. Amen? Things that God has done. Every one of us should probably be able to think about some kind of an awesome event in your life. I mean, there are all kinds of things I can think of, but I can think of when my dad was dying with tuberculosis. I was about 3 years old. I can't remember all the details, but I remember sitting there at the kitchen table that night, his first hemorrhage, and he coughed, something happened, and blood literally began to spew from my father's mouth. Rushed him to the hospital, da-da-da, you know the story. He was in Methodist Hospital diagnosed with a massive lesion of tuberculosis on his lung. They sent him to Sunnyside Sanitarium. How many of y'all remember sanitariums? It's where they sent you either to get well or died, and many people died. They sent him there. I couldn't get in to see him. My sister couldn't get in to see him. Mom could get in. I remember a blizzard came, and I remember standing in the snow outside of the window where Dad was at, and we got to wave at him and talk to him there through that window. But God healed him. The chief of staff at Sunnyside Sanitarium and his aide came and got my dad himself. Took him down. The entire surgical staff was in the room. They put Methodist Hospital's x-rays up on the reader. They put Sunnyside's x-rays up on the reader. And over on here, they circled the lesion. You could see it plain as day from Methodist Hospital. But here's Sunnyside, and there are lungs that look like they have never smoked before. There are lungs that look like they have never been scratched before. Lungs that have never caught. Like he had baby's lungs that had been put in him. Amen. Look what the Lord has done. I want three separate people right now that God is doing something in your life right now. Three, quickly, quickly, quickly. Don't wait. That is a miracle if you're having it. Amen. 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 One more. One more. Come on. What's God? Somebody. There's somebody. God's doing something in your life right now. Amen. Amen. We got these grateful husbands. Amen, babies. And this is going to be their first child. How many right now know that God is doing something in your life right now? How many of you know it? Amen. Amen. He is, isn't he? It's awesome. Let me ask you a question. What is he going to do? Are you expecting anything from him? You know, when a couple gets pregnant, when the wife gets pregnant, they say she is expecting. Right? Isn't that a term we use? Expecting what? You know, as a kid, as an adult, you know what she's expecting. But as a young person, you hear these terms. She's expecting. What's she expecting? A monkey? A bunny? No, she's expecting a baby. What are you expecting from God today? You see, if we live in a life of thankfulness for what He's done, what He's doing, and what is to come, I'm believing that He's not done yet. Amen. Amen? And if I can live in that, if you can live in that, if we can live in that life together where we are thankful, it will stop us from complaining. Pray for leadership more than you criticize leadership. Do you know that it's hard to criticize somebody you're praying for? Hey, ladies. Listen, you may not have married Prince Charming. Matter of fact, you may have thought you had Prince Charming, you didn't have to kiss the ugly toad. Then after you kissed him, he turned into an ugly toad. I don't know, you know. When I met Miss Penny, believe it or not, I was tall and skinny. I weighed 170, 175 pounds when I met her. My right leg weighs that much now. She probably weighs 5 to 10 pounds less than what she weighed when we met. 2 weeks after she had had both of our children, you couldn't even tell she had ever been pregnant. I hate her. Amen. She can eat cheesecake. I can look at cheesecake. I get a couple pounds. Anybody know what I'm talking about? But ladies, listen. While he may not be Prince Charming, he is the man that you are married to. And when you stood before God, when you stood before God and you said, I do, you didn't mean I do if he will. I do if he does. I do. Amen? And if you pray for him, it's a lot harder to criticize him if you're praying for him. Come on, help me out. I'm preaching good here. Amen. And fellas, she's the one you chose. Come on now. You can't be like a guy that show up every day at work with peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. And he'd yell and scream about peanut butter and jelly. Finally, a guy got tired of hearing. He said, buddy, why don't you tell your wife to fix you something else? He said, I'm not married. It was his choice to have peanut butter. You're married to the person you chose. Well, she tricked me. No, she didn't. Come on now. It's hard to criticize someone you're praying for. You young people, start praying harder for Troy and Christy. They need it more than ever. Come on, help me out here now. And all the rest. Pray for your pastor. And listen, I want to tell you something. I'm not a Republican, I'm not a Democrat. But I believe that if we ever prayed for a president, we need to pray for this president now. He needs to come out of Islam and become a real Christian. Amen? We need Nancy Pelosi and Harry Reid. We need leadership in this country to get saved. Amen. We need a revival in America. And I disagree with the path that we're being taken down. I don't support abortion rights. I don't support the homosexual agenda and much more. I think that it's horrible that in a lot of hotels, the Gideon Bibles are being thrown out and porn is being brought in. I think it's horrible that kids can get condoms at school easier than in some cases than they can get Bibles. A friend of mine here in Shepherdsville has a Big O Tires. He's a Christian man. He has Bibles. He supports the work of the Lord all over this city and county. But he has Bibles, free Bibles on his counter. Now check this out. This is the prevailing attitude of our world, our nation, I should say. A guy came in to get his tire changed, and while he was waiting at the counter, when he finally stepped on the counter, he looked at Jim and he said, "Hey, I don't think that that's right." And he said, "What do you mean?" He said, "I don't think you're allowed to have them Bibles sitting out on your counter." And Jim told him, said, "Listen, this is my business, and I'll put on that counter what I want to put on that counter, and that's the Word of God, and we're going to give it away anybody that wants it." But here's what they were thinking, amen? Yeah, amen, that's right. Here's what the guy's thinking, though, because along the line, some idiot said separation of church and state. They think that's in the Constitution, but it's not in the Constitution. And it first came into being under Franklin Delano Roosevelt when he began to appoint judges and justices who began to use that term to the point that one justice said, "If we don't stop using this term, separation of church and state, people are going to think that it actually exists in the Constitution." Well, the First Amendment has the separation clause. The First Amendment, if you would take the time to read it, at no place does it ever say church, state, or separation. The only place that's ever mentioned in any document was in a private letter that Thomas Jefferson wrote to some Baptist preachers. That'd all come out of that. Pray. Our country needs prayer right now. Our pastors, our denominational leadership, they need prayer lest we fall into this place. I got to go. Obey even if you don't understand. I know some people disagree with that. But I'm going to simply say this. This idea has to do with discipline. When I went into the military in July 16th, 1976, it was a Friday. I remember my mom and dad drove me down to the AFI station. We sat around there until finally we got to do the swearing-in ceremony. And then they wouldn't let me ride to the airport. I guess they was afraid I'd change my mind. You couldn't ride with your parents. You had to get on a bus and go to the airport, and then you could meet with your parents and family again at the airport. I got on a plane and flew to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, then ended up in a 15-passenger van to Fort Dix, New Jersey. We got to lay down somewhere around 2 o'clock that morning. I don't know, around 5 or so, they got us up, put us outside. We stood outside in the dark for close to 2 hours. Finally, we fed us breakfast. Then they took us to a barber shop. This is the 17th of July at Fort Dix, New Jersey. At that time, I had kind of let my hair grow down to about right here. I have terminal white man's disease. I burn, I peel, I burn, I peel, I don't tan. Anybody know what I'm talking about? They shaved my head. My Class A pictures, I look like a lobster wearing green. Because after they cut our hair off, they stood us outside for the rest of the day in the July sun. But the point I'm trying to make is that it wasn't just the white guys that they cut all their hair off. They cut the black guys' afros off. They cut the Hispanic guys' greased back, slit back hair off. It didn't matter what color you were, what nationality that you were, they cut your hair off, and then on Monday morning they marched us down and they gave us a uniform that was called olive drab green. Amen? And we all put it on, and we all put on our hats, and we all put on our boots, and our civilian stuff got put in a bag and got locked away because they wanted us all to look the same, to march the same, and to act the same. What were they trying to do? They were trying to make us a part of a unit. Burt Clendenin said that basic training as a Marine, he thought they were going to kill him. He said, "I thought all they wanted me to do was sign up and shoot Japanese." He said, "I could strike a match with a .22 rifle at 50 yards. But," he said, "they made me run through those hills, lift those logs, do those push-ups, all that stuff." Then he went through infantry training. He said, "I never fully understood it until we hit that first beach. The shells coming from the ships out in the ocean, the aircraft coming in, and the enemy in the hills firing mortars and artillery rounds down at them." He said, "When the first sergeant said, 'Hit the deck,' everyone who said, 'Huh,' died." Did you get me? Everyone who said, huh, got their head blowed off. It was only the people who didn't say, I don't get what he said. No, it was only the people when he said hit the deck, that they hit the deck, that survived. Sometimes you have to do what you're told without understanding why you've been told. Amen? Remember, as a parent, sometimes you as the parent have told your children, because I said so. Amen. Do or die. Don't question why. Here's one that would help us all. Everybody just shout the victory on this one right here. Think before you speak. Amen. How many guys in the room have said something that you wish you could pull it back and it's too late? Yes, I see both those hands. Amen. Ladies, this is why sometimes when we say something, if you ask us what we said, we had a chance to think about it, and we'll go, nothing. Come on, guys, say amen. I know we're letting in a little trade secret there. But that's exactly what that means, nothing. You ever seen that Kit Kat commercial where the guy stuffs the stuff in his mouth? And if she ever asks you, what are you thinking? Think about it before you tell her. Ask the Lord to help you with murmuring. He will. I got to go hurry. Above all, everybody read this one with me. Above all, even if you disagree, do so agreeably. I think that bears repeating. Even if you disagree, do so agreeably. Can I tell you something? Every person in this room, there is no reason over any issue, whether it's the color of the carpet, what kind of chairs, what kind of t-shirts, what kind of paint, what kind of this, what kind of sound, what kind of music. There is no reason why Christians should ever be ugly. Can I just say it again? You say it with me. There is no reason why Christians should ever be ugly. Well, I think sometimes the perception is as well, I wasn't being ugly. I was just being forceful. That's why there's like 16 people laying out there dead. Amen. Come on. Sometimes we need to check our attitude at the door. Amen. Listen, the whole is always more important than the will of one. We're not always going to agree on every issue of doctrine, but as long as you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that salvation is through His name and His name alone, we can argue about the rest of it. I mean, we can get over the rest of it. We don't have to fuss and fight and feud about everything. Amen? Now check it out. One last thought I want you to see. A gentle answer turns away wrath. Sometimes speaking softly will get the trick done. One last thought. I leave you with this one last thought. I don't think I've come across a more potent thing. I got this. Pastor Troy Bond sent me a letter. And I read this and I kind of embellished a bit what he said. And that's this. Some crossed at the Red Sea, but never crossed the Jordan. Some crossed the Red Sea, never got across the Jordan. Isn't that tragic? Can you just marinate on that for a minute? Some crossed the Red Sea. Can you imagine what a celebration they had? Read that sometime. They look back out there. Here comes the Egyptian army. And you know the Egyptian army's got to be freaking out. Somebody had to be murmuring a little bit. Are you sure we ought to be doing this? Because you're looking up water all around you. Now, if you're from that camp that believes the water was only 6 inches deep, that's really cool. You know, whatever you think, you know. But there's still a miracle going to take place here somewhere, because if the Word of God is true, He drowned them in 6 inches of water, or He drowned them in 30 feet of water. It doesn't really matter. The Bible says that God destroyed, He delivered the children of Israel, and He destroyed their enemies. I don't know why we're debating whether or not a miracle took place. But they're on the other side of the Red Sea, and they're dancing and rejoicing because not only have they been delivered from Egypt, but Pharaoh's army has been destroyed, so never again can they be dragged back to Egypt. Do you understand what Jesus did for you and I at the cross? When He said, "It is finished," it means that sin's power was broken in such a way that all who come to Him for salvation, the devil no longer has the power to drag you down. You were born of the sin nature, therefore you cannot help yourself until you come to Christ. But you are made a new creation in Christ. You've been set free. The devil no longer has a hold on you or me. Amen? So they're dancing and they're shouting and they're rejoicing on the other side of the Red Sea. But the problem is that the Red Sea on the other side of the Red Sea was not the destination. The destination was back home to Canaan. And yet, many of those, most of those who crossed the Red Sea didn't cross the Jordan. What happened? This thing we've been preaching about for 4 weeks. They murmured. They complained. They rebelled. They forgot. And God said, "You don't get to cross." Isn't it awful that it was what they did with their lips more than what they did with their bodies that kept them from getting the victory? Can I say that again? It was what they did, they sinned with their lips more than they sinned with their bodies that kept them from getting the victory. I don't know about you, but I want everything God has for me. How about you today? I want it all. Do you know what? I got to be honest. I am my own worst enemy. Amen? I'm not like Flip Wilson. I can't say the devil made me do it. I look at stupid things I've done and I say, "Rusty, why did you do that?" Anybody else? Is it just me? Or is it? You know, I could have had a V8 thing. Some mornings I get up and I'm like, I can hear the voice of the Lord. You know, get on the bike or get in the car, go down to the church and you know, spend some time. And I'll be like, "Oh man, I'm running late. I need to get," and I'll get going, and I'll be about halfway through the day and it's like I'm totally defeated. And it's like, I could have prayed first. Anybody else know what I'm talking about? I most of the time don't venture into an arena where the devil has to worry about stopping me because I do a good job of doing that to myself. Let's not be guilty. Let's not be guilty of denying ourselves what God wants us to have by the words of our mouth. Instead of cursing, brothers and sisters, let blessing flow forth from these lips. You say, "Pastor, have you got it all fixed?" No, but I'm working on it. I was talking to Brucey the other day, and the guy cut me off, and I said, "Man, would you..." And I said, "Hey, wait, I just saved an idiot. I didn't spend one." Just simple little things, simple little steps. Be surprised. At the end of the day, you can look back. Instead of complaining on how bad the day has gone, you can look back and say, "My, look what the Lord has done." Remember, the start of Psalm 106 says, "Praise the Lord, because God is good." Amen. Let's stand together. Amen. How's your hearts this morning? How's your hearts? Do you know this morning that everything is well with your soul? We just ask you for just a moment in time, if you would, to bow your heads with me. See, every time we come together and every time we talk about this thing called the Bible, there's always a chance that there's somebody with us, somebody listening, who doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And oftentimes, while the thrust of what we do is directed toward helping Christians, to educating Christians, the reality is that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. More than anything else, our mission is to see people saved. That's why I love the Gideons, because they want the Word of God to go forth. Is there anybody here today that would say, "Pastor, personally, I am not a Christian. I know I ask for you all to pray for me, to lift me up. I do not know that I'm a Christian." Is there anybody that would just slip your hand up? Let me promise you this. Nobody will come and point you out. Nobody will try to come and get you or do anything to embarrass you. It's simply a chance for you to respond. That's a chance to pray. Anybody who would maybe raise your hand? Is there anybody here this morning who would say, "Pastor, I am a Christian, but sometimes I forget what God has done for me"? Anybody like that? Amen. 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 Is there anybody here this morning who would say, "Pastor, sometimes I think I spend more time complaining than I do praising"? Amen. Amen. I I raise my hand to that one. But there are times when I allow myself to get caught in this. Maybe just simply here today you would say, Pastor, I'm asking the Lord to help me. I want to grow. I want to become. I want to receive all that He would have me be, all that He would give for me. Would you pray for me? God bless you. Yes. Here's what I want to simply do. Just as He simply plays this song. Not even sing, just the playing of the song. If you need to pray this morning, why don't you just slip out of your seat and just take a few moments here just to kneel down. Maybe just to consecrate in your heart, whatever it may be. The issue, you raise your hand for prayer. Amen. Now what I ask is that if you can, just maybe somebody might come and slip up here behind one of your friends, one of your brothers and sisters, put your hand on their shoulder and lift them up to the Lord in prayer. You don't have to say a word. You don't have to do a thing. Just let them know that you're here behind them.